Hi, I'm John Hennessey, and I make fast cars go faster. Actually, our team does. Something I started doing as a passion about 24 years ago, and now we have a whole army of folks that help us do it at Hennessey Performance. You know, I'm probably like a lot of car enthusiasts where I had a passion for fast cars, and back in the late 80s, the Porsche 959 was kind of my dream car. And at that time, you couldn't get them over here, and if you could, they were, you know, Bill Gates money. So I thought, well, what's something that's coming that maybe I can make into my own poor man's version of a 959? In 91, Mitsubishi came out with a 3000 GT VR4, twin turbo V6, all-wheel drive, four-wheel steer, active aero. And I thought, maybe that's a car I can get with 300 horsepower, modify it, and see if I can get it to 450 horsepower. So I bought it, modified it, intended to take it to Pikes Peak. But I learned the first rule in racing, which is if you want to make a small fortune in racing, you start with a larger fortune. So as I'm doing all this and having fun racing, I'm watching my bank account kind of headed south, and I thought, you know what, I really like this racing thing, and the car thing's a lot of fun, and maybe there's somebody else out there that has a car like mine that they would want to modify it. And that's kind of how the business began, as a hobby that got out of control. Back in the early 90s, we started with the 3000 GT. At that time, you had the 306 twin turbo, you had the Mark IV Toyota Supra with the twin turbo. So at that time, our niche was kind of turbo Japanese cars. And then one day, a guy with a 92 Viper called me up in early 93 and said, hey, I got a new Viper coming, what can you do with it? I want to do that Silver State race. And so I'm like, yeah, send it to us, we'll figure it out. And we started doing some Viper work. And then in 2005, when the C6 Z06 Corvette came out, it was less money, it performed better, it was a better daily driver. And so we saw the Viper business really kind of taper off significantly. And I thought, you know what, it'd probably be a good idea to be a little more diverse and not be married to one particular car brand. So in 2007, 2008, when the newer CTS-V came out, and then along the ZR1 and other vehicles, we thought, okay, we need to be more diverse. And so, you know, there's always some particular vehicle that's kind of the popular vehicle of the time, and they kind of go in about 18-month spurts. So for a long time it was the Camaro SS, and now there's a lot of ZL1 Camaros. You'll see a lot of C7 Corvettes here. Ford Raptors that we do our Velociraptor kit on are very, very popular. So at any given time, there's a kind of an ebb and flow of what's cool and what's popular, but I would say that the majority of our work is geared towards Ford products and towards GM products, but we also do Mercedes and Porsches and other kind of niche vehicles that we like, and we're always kind of looking for the new vehicle that might come down the pike in terms of something that we find that's interesting, that we think that there might be a niche of performance guys like us that say, hey, you know, if a new 2015 Mustang with 435 horse is good, then maybe one with 700 and plus horsepower would even be better.
We really pride ourselves on reliability and drivability of the vehicles. We really want to make sure that the customer's cars are still very much usable, that the horsepower doesn't take away from the driving experience, instead enhance it.
In terms of the whole R&D process, we're kind of like maybe one of these Wall Street analysts where we're looking for value that has not been achieved yet. And so we're looking at, okay, did the factory build it with the ability to make 600 or 700 horsepower, but they started off really conservative with 420 or 460. And so we're looking to basically tap into and unleash that power, especially in packages where the drivetrain, the transmission, the brakes, the suspension are all kind of geared up to where it can handle more power. So every car is different. A lot of times, if something that comes out brand new, when the C7 Vette came out, there was no blower, there was no turbo, there wasn't anything. And so we're fully prepared and capable of starting from scratch, and then over time, develop a package to where we can be efficient at it, we can we can be profitable at it.
The Raptor has obviously been something really big for us. I think we've done almost 500 units at this point, and really we're building the vehicle that I think a lot of customers were expecting. The Raptor's a really cool package with suspension and looks, and obviously the 6.2 motor is pretty cool, but it's not a fast truck by any means. It's only a little bit faster than most half tons that are out there. Well, once you put a supercharger on that thing, it's what everybody wants. And then obviously we have the special models of that, the Velociraptor SUV. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we have our 800 horsepower twin turbo Raptor, which we just delivered one recently, and I got one of the best feedback from a customer I've ever received. It defies physics. The fact that a 6,000 pound truck can accelerate from 60 to 100 faster than you can expect is just really cool. And obviously hearing those turbos blow off on a big lifted truck is pretty awesome.
We have a deal with AutoNation now where somebody can go into AutoNation Ford here in Katy or out in Southern California or down in Florida or wherever they're located and say, hey, I wanna get a new 2015 Mustang. I wanna order the HP 700 upgrade package. Or they could do the same thing with a new Corvette, a Z06, a truck, a Tahoe.
You know, the guy that drives a Corvette and has a cool 700 horsepower Corvette from us, he doesn't want his wife to have a basic SUV. He doesn't want it to be boring every time he drives it. So we have products for that too. And really the Escalades are some of the coolest products. We have an Escalade where we take it all the way up to 650 horsepower, and I don't know who has the opportunity to drive that, but that is a really cool car. When you can get in, you're able to stay door-to-door, beat most V8 sports cars out there is something really cool.
We're the only type of a tuner that's listed in the NADA book, so if you go with like our full packages, it actually increases the value of our car.
Clients will spend, our average vehicle here is probably in the $10,000 to $25,000 range, but the 90% of those guys, they only want to be without their car for 30 days. And the big builds, the big twin turbo 1,000 and 2,000 horsepower builds, those are months and in some cases 6 months or a year. And so we've really tried to gear our whole company up to where, you know, we have a whole army of people that, in terms of customer service, production, that can help execute that. In almost kind of a way, we're kind of like a little miniature Texas version of an AMG, but we're not brand specific. We're not just doing Mercedes. We're not just doing the Viper. We do a variety of vehicles, and we have great relationships with a lot of the manufacturers, and that diversity gives us the ability to respond quickly and always stay busy. Over time, young guys would, you know, they'd see an article in Motor Trend or they'd see a video on YouTube and they'd say, well, hey, how can I learn how to do what you guys do? And we'd say, well, hey, go talk to the guys at UTI, go talk to Clemson, has a motorsports engineering program, or go talk to McPherson College, and they'd all circle back around. They'd say, well, I don't want to learn how to fix cars, and I don't want to become a motorsports engineer. I don't want to restore old cars. I want to learn how to modify cars like you guys.
So John had the idea to come up with a school. It started with something really small, a few students at a time. They were modifying a old Mustang that got a supercharger, and they had a turbo Honda, and that was the beginning. Over the past 5 years, it's grown to a school where we now take 15 to 20 young men and women who are out of high school, who may be recent veterans out of our armed forces, or people just looking for a career change, and they spend 14 weeks with us and learn how to modify cars. Part of our curriculum, almost half, is what we do out in the shop, actual installs on cars. Currently, we have a Camaro and a Mustang that they take from 350 to about 650 horsepower. So our students actually get to bolt parts on cars, see how the tuning changes, dyno those cars, test those cars on the track, take them to different events and show them off. So they have a very good picture of how things go in the industry and are ready to work. And that's what I hear feedback from employers is, 14 weeks is intense, and they come out ready to work. They have some skills, and we just pick up where you left off and get them trained for our company.
And we got some really cool stories. Some of these students are now off working at some pretty neat places. And there was one young man that was working for an exotic car rental car company up in Vegas. He's basically in charge of taking care of these exotic cars from Lamborghinis to Ferraris for people that come up there and want to do like a 4 or 5 lap experience. And so they have the passion that I had, but now they kind of have a way where there's a whole lot less trial and error and pain and suffering as a result of it. Hopefully they get a little further down the road than it took me initially. And then we also are able to use that for recruiting guys into our organization as needed. So it's a neat deal.
We just require a high school diploma, driver's license, basic things like that. The only thing is that as we grow in popularity, we will have to start limiting who we can take. We're only taking about 15 to 20 students at a time right now. So at some point it's going to depend on who's most passionate about cars. We get a letter from every student that says why they want to be in the school, why they want to be in the industry, and we hear some really cool stories. So we take all that together, put our class together, and go from there.
Probably one of my favorite projects that I've had a chance to work on, I would assume, is the Venom GT project.
We're all proud of it. We're all involved in it. For those who haven't seen one in person, it's wide, it's long, it's low. It sounds like a drag car. It is incredible. Just to be able to work around that car is an awesome experience. And then to be here this February when we got the world record was obviously really special.
The Venom GT is it was just kind of a crazy idea. In 2007, Road and Track Magazine had a shootout to see which vehicle they could get to go from 0 to 200 miles per hour in the shortest amount of time. So there's a Bugatti Veyron there, roof Porsche, Lamborghini, modified Corvette, and a handful of other cars, and we brought a twin turbo Viper. And at the end of the shootout, we were in first place. We did 0 to 200 in around 20 seconds. The Veyron was second at about 24 seconds. So 4 seconds faster than the Bugatti. We thought that was pretty cool, but like any time you have some level of success at a goal, maybe it wasn't 2 weeks later, I'm thinking, okay, what's next? And at that time, I realized that just continuing to add horsepower is not always the answer. I thought, well, what if we had the same level of horsepower, 1,000, 1,100 horsepower, but instead of having a 3,500 pound car, we had a 2,000 pound car, 2,400 pound car. I didn't initially want to start off like a Pagani or a Koenigsegg. We're completely starting from scratch. I just felt like that was just too far out of our wheelhouse. We modify cars. And so one day I was just kind of joking with some guys about, well, what if we took like a Lotus Exige or an Elise and we put a twin turbo Venom 1000 Viper engine in the back, and how cool would that be? Well, I had a guy that was doing some rendering work for me at the time. I'm like, could you do a set of renderings that would be like really representative of what the car might look like? When he sent me the renderings, I looked at it and I'm like, wow, I think we could build that car. So we did the Road and Track thing. We came out in September. I was at the SEMA show in early November of 07. And Spinelli or Matt Hardegger, one of the early Jalopnik guys, came up to me with a camera and just like, hey, what's new, Hennessey? What do you got that's new? I'm like, this happens to be your lucky day, my man. And pull my pictures out of my bag, and I'm like, here's the Venom GT concept. I'm just thinking, this is my crazy idea. I don't know if we're going to do this or not. And all of a sudden, I didn't really realize the kind of the power of the internet at that particular time. Well, I figured it out real fast because all of a sudden, the whole story's around the world. And a couple weeks later, a sheikh from the Middle East calls me up and says, I want to order a car. I'm like, okay. I haven't really kind of thought that far down the road, but so we ended up working up a number that we felt like would be, we came up with a number of $1 million. I'm thinking, okay, for $1 million, I can do all the engineering, the development work, the tooling, and build a prototype car, and build his production car, and maybe kind of break even. Well, 2 years later, when his car was completed, we built the prototype, we'd finish his particular vehicle, and we ended up spending $3 million instead of the one. So somewhere along the way, the economics started becoming very real. I'm like, well, I'm committed to this deal now. I got to sell more cars, and which we did. When we got to around car number 5 or 6, we were at break even, and now we've built and delivered a dozen cars. It's been cool. I mean, the whole goal of the car along was to be the fastest under whatever definition, whether it's 0 to 200 miles an hour or top speed, and we've demonstrated that with a Guinness record of 300 kilometers. Guinness doesn't do miles per hour; it's a world record, so it has to be in metric. You can have the components, you can have the car, you can have the horsepower, you can have whatever, but if they're not aligned in the correct way, you're not going to achieve whatever the goal is. The GT with the wing up and with the track splitter on there has got 1,500 pounds of downforce at 150 miles an hour. Now, with that level of downforce, you can't go out and go 270. We need a lower drag front splitter, and then we designed the wing to retract. And so when we did the original CFD analysis on the computer, it basically said 272 with around 1,200 horsepower. The whole CFD thing, the computational fluid dynamics, the aerodynamic work in the computer was something that was fairly new. The aerospace industry has been doing it for a long time. but the computer says one thing, well, I'm like, well, the computer always says something, but the real world says something different. And I won't believe it until I see what the car does in the real world. Well, we went out to Lemoore Naval Air Station out in California, Navy Air Base out in Central California, hit 264, 265 on a couple of runs, and just didn't have a long enough runway. And so we knew, at that point, we knew the car was stable. We knew it could run the number. And then it's kind of a whole other story working with NASA and figuring out a way how do we get into NASA to test our car. But the runway was a little bit longer. Instead of 2.9 miles, it's 3.2. So that extra 2 or 3 tenths gave us the extra room that we needed to go from 265 to 270. And the car was still pulling. At the end of the run on the V-Box data, it went from 260 to 270 in 11 seconds. So it gained 10 miles per hour at that speed in 11 seconds and was still pulling. So I guess if we had another mile to run, the car would have probably gone to 275. And if we had like Aero Lausanne, the Volkswagen Bugatti test track over in Germany, I mean, 280 something most likely. What's next is the Venom F5. So based on what we learned from the GT, we're now in a position to build our own car, our own bespoke chassis, our own bespoke everything. Still a significant amount of downforce, but not quite as much. It'll probably go from a 0.44 to maybe a 0.37 or 38. The F5 will have more horsepower. In testing, we've developed way more than 1,244 horsepower. We're waiting to see what the Bugatti boys throw out there at some future point. The F5 will have a higher tech deal in terms of the paddle shift, more options in terms of having a GPS managed track configuration, so you can go out on a track and do some crazy stuff, and based on where the GPS knows you're at, it will allow you to have a certain amount of slip angle or a certain amount of horsepower. People look at the car and say, that's a Hennessey. That's not some sort of the Venom GT where you still have the Lotus headlamp and you still have a few design cues in there, which looking backwards, that was a regret a little bit, is that I think we kept too much of the Lotus DNA in the look of the car. But at the end of the day, the whole premise of going with the Lotus was to have something that was very lightweight. And that's what makes the GT and the F5 very unique, is that they're lighter than Pagani, Koenigsegg, McLaren, LaFerrari. And then people are like, well, you know, these guys are, other guys are more high tech. I'm like, you know, to me, being the fastest, being the guy that's out front and having the most fun, to me, that's winning. You know, if you guys want to win by, well, you know, we did this by engineering this and we made our own bespoke switch over here. I'm like, great. You guys can have the fancy watch and we'll be happy with being in first place.
To get into this industry, it's just follow your passion. And that's what I did, and that's what I want to tell everybody else. Before I came here, I was an attorney for 5 years. I was doing pretty well at it, but I promise I'm a lot better in this high performance industry because this is what I'm passionate about, this is what I love.
You know, myself, I was an enthusiast, and you know, I worked my way through the ranks and networking and was able to make a name for myself, so that when opportunities like my current situation opened up, I was able to have the skill set to fill that need.
You know, the cream always rises to the top, and passion will overcome. If you don't have the money, if you don't have the experience, if you don't have the whatever, for me it was, you know, cars and going fast, and other people have other passions, but you can definitely make a business out of your hobby if you try hard enough and you work at it and you're running with the right folks. Ow, we're living in the fast lane, baby.